the two cetasikas, the two lectures. First lecture will be about Uddhacca. So after this week, I'll be concluding the cetasika chapter about some significance of certain cetasikas, and then about mentalities. Then we proceed to the next week. In another 2 weeks, we proceed to the causality of the causality, like cause and effect nature. So today it's about Uddhacca. Uddhacca is normally we translate it as restlessness. So the mind becomes restless when it doesn't focus upon a certain object very firmly. So at that time we call the mind is restless. The nature which causes for this, for the mind to become restless, to not to become stable on a particular object, is called restlessness. So this is in Buddhism is considered as a different mentality, mental concomitant. So we call it Uddhacca. It makes the mind unstable in focusing on a certain object. Actually, one mind has one object at a time. So there is a certain focus, but Uddhacca makes the mind to become, take the object in a manner that soon it would give up the object and moves to another object. So it means its focus, grasping of the object, grasping here doesn't mean upadana, grasping means cognizing. The cognition becomes weaker and unstable. So therefore, so very soon another citta would arise, going to another object. That is the functioning of Uddhacca, and it did really disturbs especially the meditation of a yogi. So a lot of yogis struggle to focus on a particular object because of this Uddhacca. Uddhacca makes the mind to move from one object to another, mostly without any relationship. It's like you go from one end to another end without any connection. So it's like a very, we can call the mind is scattered. It goes here and there when Uddhacca is present. So if you read the first paragraph, mental factor which makes the mind restless is called Uddhacca. It can also be termed as the restless nature of a restless mind. It means restlessness. It means restlessness. When Uddhacca is connected, co-arising mentalities become unstable in focusing upon objects they cognize. This instability is figuratively referred as shaking, but it has no shaking because it's not a material thing, the mind, but we normally call the mind is shaking. As a ball made out of rubber repeatedly bumps when it falls upon the ground, unlike a clay ball which sticks to the ground, when Uddhacca is present, mentalities do not become entrenched on an object, become stable on an object. The figurative word shaking of the mind means instability of mentalities in cognizing the object firmly with high focus. So Uddhacca makes the mind to not to be well focused on a certain object. So it is greatly opposite of ekaggatā. It's different from ekaggatā. So Uddhacca is also present in all akusala cittas. The reason is the oppression made by the akusala. Akusalas is loba, dosa, moha, then we call ditti, mana, dhinamida. All these akusala natures torment, oppress the mind, associated mentalities, and also the base upon which it depends. So therefore this oppression, now for example, when the person is in severe pain, it's not easy for him to be calm and be in one posture. He finds ease in frequently changing his postures and moving his limbs. So likewise, when the mind is being oppressed or tormented by defilements, it starts, stability, it cannot be calm. It finds ease in shaking. Shaking being become restless. So that is one kind of a mental attribute that we experience in our consciousness. So restlessness is inevitable when there is defilement. The reason is the unease it produces within the mind stream. So we normally say Uddhacca appears in all the akusala cittas. Then another, on the other way, it's like vice versa. Uddhacca also supports the arising of unwholesome defilements. For instance, like when someone is well composed in doing wholesome deeds, in him it is not possible for unwholesome mentalities to arise. So when someone is well focused and delighted in wholesome deeds, it is not possible for akusala natures to arise within him. So therefore, Uddhacca is something which is opposite, or opposite means opposing to the good wholesome natures, like sobhana, beautiful mentalities. Therefore, Uddhacca also becomes a fundamental necessity or a condition for whatever akusala nature to arise. It also facilitates the arising of akusala. And on the other hand, akusalas themselves causes the arising of Uddhacca. So that's why in Patthana we call all the akusala natures, mentalities are supporting each other. So Uddhacca supports the arising of akusalas, the akusalas support the arising of Uddhacca. So if I repeat again, when the, because of the torment made by the akusala natures, the mind gets this restless quality. Then also this restless quality is necessary for untamed akusalas to happen, because akusala is always untamed. They are in extremes, like because they don't bring peace. So how to define, now when we go into the ultimate definition of kusala and akusala, how to understand kusala and akusala practically in according to the ultimate definition? Because yesterday I mentioned in Buddhism we have a definition: kusala is good, akusala is bad. So how to understand, or how to make sure, or how to verify this thing is, when akusalas appear in our mind, it brings unpleasant sorts of feelings. Sometimes when the somanasa, like for example happiness with lobha, appears, we may have a very pleasant feeling, but it is different from the feeling we get with kusala. It is one sort of a peaceful nature which happens within us. So kusalas are the, ultimately they bring peace, calm into our mind and into our body. But when it comes to akusalas, there is sort of a burning nature. Even though piti connected with lobha can be pleasant for a certain moment, for a certain degree, but if it keeps on happening, and if you measure it with the kusala natures, you find that it's also a sort of there is a sort of uncomfortableness. You can feel this when you have come into a very high level of kusala and suddenly you go into a lobha state with happiness. You find the mind state and the body, the feelings of the body, emotions, the sensations of the body changes. There is a change. It is better than the dosa. It's sure, lobha is more pleasant than the dosa and it brings more comfort to the body. But when compared with the comfort brought by kusala, that is different. So therefore, to define what is kusala and akusala, the natures on present moment which bring comfort is considered as sobhana, which brings discomfort is considered as akusala. So therefore, the akusala natures always supports restlessness, and also restlessness supports the arising of untamed akusalas. Then with Uddhacca, when the mind is occupied by Uddhacca, it shakes like a flag struck by the wind. And also a figurative statement is given, it is like a pile of ashes struck by a stone. So it becomes completely scatters, right? So likewise, the mind gets scattered when there is excessive Uddhacca. In Sanghārava Sutta of the Sanyutta Nikaya, Buddha gave a simile, Uddhacca, to a water struck by the wind. You know the five hindrances were symbolized, right? So, kāmacchanda is like when the water is mixed with some dye, some color, it's like kāmacchanda. You cannot see the bottoms of the water. Then when the water is boiling, it's like the vyapada, dosa, has occupied our mind. When there is certain moss in the water, moss means like certain plants in the water, at that time you cannot see through. So likewise, when tinamida is present, we cannot recall what we have memorized and we cannot have deep penetration into our life. Then when the water is shaking, struck by wind, Like when the mind is occupied by Uddhacca, is restless, at that time we cannot have a good focus. Finally, vichikicca is similar to what, when mind is occupied by vichikicca, it is similar to water, muddy water. At that time also, you cannot see through. These are the examples Buddha gave. Because Brahmin Sangharava, he asked the question. I have memorized lots of suttas in past when I was young, but now I cannot, sometimes I cannot recall them. In sometimes he cannot recall these suttas. So Buddha mentioned, when the mind is occupied by nivaranas, it becomes unclear, so you cannot recall what you have memorized in your mind. So that is how the Buddha has explained how the excessive Uddhacca disturbs our mind. Then this Uddhacca, when you look into the Dhamma Sangani in the text, you find Uddhacca was, we normally say Uddhacca is present in all akusala cittas. But if you go to Dhamma Sangani, it is enumerated as a separate cetasika only in the 12th citta. You know the 12th citta, there are 8 lobhamula cittas, 2 dosamula cittas, 10. 11th is the vichikicca sampayutta citta, 12th is the Uddhacca sampayutta citta. So only in this citta, Uddhacca has been enumerated as a separate cetasika. The reason for that is its excessive nature. So when the moha is the most fundamental akusala quality, when moha is occupied by lobha or dosa, we normally say it is influenced by lobha and dosa. Moha is ignorance. So when ignorance is there together with lobha, it goes together with lobha. So the person doesn't see the defects of the object, doesn't see the bad side of the object. So that's why the lobha arises and it gets attached to the object. So we say normally ignorance has a huge scope. So when it is influenced by lobha, the mind starts to see the good side of an object which are not actual. Then when it's influenced by dosa, it starts to see the bad side of the object which is also not necessary. So why do I say it's not actual and necessary? Because according to Buddhism, there is no object that you have to attach, and there is no object that we should get angry about, or we should dislike. There is two types of disliking. Here what I mean is disliking is with the unpleasant mind. So when we consider our body as a repulsive thing, so that is also we start to dislike the object. When we start to see the sankhara as an impermanent suffering and non-self, also we start to get dislike the object. But at that time, it is occupied by wisdom. So it's just we are considering the actual natures of the object and we see its defects. But when this bad side of an object influences our mind and it bothers us, at that time, the mind also turns into domanasa. Domanasa means it becomes like rotten. So this type of dislike is what we call dosa. Otherwise, disliking, what happens with dosa? Otherwise, it's not all disliking is condemned in Buddhism. Because when you talk about vipassana, we are starting to dislike the sankharas. When asubha meditation, we start to dislike. Dislike means we start to see the defects of the body. But at that time, it is not affected. Affected means it's not emotional. We are not emotionally affected. Even now, there is a meditation called ahara patikula sanya. You see the repulsiveness of the food. So this, even in this meditation, person starts to see the bad side or how it is repulsive. The food is repulsive, and starts to get detached from the food. But if the unwise attention was not paid at, or if unwise attention comes in, at that time he may feel a disgusting feeling. It means an emotional type of a dislike. This is, at that moment we say we go out of the meditation. So when this disliking thing happens in an emotional level, so at that moment our mind turns into domanasa. This is not acceptable, is not admired in Buddhism. But knowing the actual defects of an object is done with wisdom. At that moment, the person is not emotionally affected by the presence of the object. So that is the two things. So if I come back to where did I stop? There is no object to which we have to get attached, or there is no object that we should dislike in the sense of having dosa. That is one of the basic theories of Buddhism. So therefore, if someone gets attached to a certain object, we normally say there is a moha. If someone starts to have anger towards a certain object, that time we say there is also moha. But when dosa or loba is present, moha is influenced by dosa. In the cases where there is no loba or dosa, at that time the moha functions excessively. So when the moha functions excessively regarding a particular object, we have two options. Either it falls into doubt, or either it starts to get excessively restless. It starts to get excessively restless, or it starts to doubt the actual phenomenon. So that is why we say the last two cittas have a great level of moha. So sometimes instead of saying moha mula cittas, normally you study as moha mula. We also call it momuha. Momuha means it is with more, excessive moha, high level of delusion. So when in the Uddhacca Sampayutta Citta, because of excessive moha, the mind has turned into restlessness, high level of restlessness. To point out this, the Buddha, it's mentioned in the Abhidhamma, it's Uddhacca has been enumerated separately as a mental factor. In other cittas, it is found as a yevapanaka cetasika. Yevapanaka means in some cetasikas are not counted, because at the end of each citta it says yevapana anyepi atti paticca samuppanna dhamma, whatever remaining conditioned realities. So there's a term at the end of every citta. So we include Uddhacca in that group. So it means Uddhacca, according to Abhidhamma, is found in every citta, but it is enumerated as a separate citta, separate cetasika, only in the 12th akusala citta, right? So then a possible question that can happen is, because if when we say Uddhacca is present in all akusala citta, we also know there are seven universal cetasikas which happen in all the cittas, regardless whether it's wholesome or unwholesome. They are passa, vedana, sanya, sachetana, ekaggatā, jivitindriya and manasika. We call it sabbacitta sadharana, seven universal cetasikas. So among these seven, we have ekaggatā, one-pointedness. So we normally, when in high spiritual practice, we call it samadhi. So samadhi, whether it's perhaps good or bad, kusala or akusala, one-pointedness is present in all cittas. It means in all akusala cittas even. And we also say this restlessness, which is opposite of ekaggatā, is also found in all the akusala cittas. So how could these two, ekaggatā and restlessness, exist together? So this is a question to be answered. So answer given is, it's like the ekaggatā in akusala citta is like a jockey, you know, the one who runs horseback. It, while the horse moves, it goes up and down. The citta, actually citta in the citta is not the ekaggatā, citta is like a jockey. So it goes up and down, at the same time it remains without falling. So likewise, the citta, because of influence of the Uddhacca, it is shaking, it's not stably taking the object, but at the same time, because of ekaggatā, a fundamental necessity of cognition, we discussed this in the lesson of consciousness, it is required for every citta, ekaggatā is required for every citta, so it focuses on one of the aspects of the object. So these are two things, right? So citta focuses on one of the aspects, at the same time, its focus, it's shaking on that particular object. It's not focused well on the particular. It's this instability of focus is caused by Uddhacca. But still, since as a fundamental necessity, it focuses on one aspect of the object because of ekaggatā. So ekaggatā is greatly weakened by the presence of Uddhacca. So we also, if I remind a lesson we already discussed, focusing on one object, focusing on a one aspect of the object are two things. Focusing on a one object is the characteristics of viññāṇa. What is the viññāṇa, function of viññāṇa? Because there are lots of countless objects in the world. So viññāṇa focuses on a one particular object, delimiting it from others, and focuses on a particular one object. This is the function of viññāṇa. V is having separated it from others, it focuses. So that is the functioning of viññāṇa. So in a particular one object even, there are many aspects the object can be taken. It can be seen in many angles, it can be known in many aspects. For example, we can consider something, a bottle, red color bottle, a red color thing, a glass thing, or something which can contain water. So likewise, various aspects are found in one object. So when the citta focuses on one object, it has to focus on one of these aspects. So ekaggatā, the functioning of ekaggatā is making the citta, placing the citta in one of the many aspects of one object at which can be cognized. So the functioning of focusing on one object is because of the citta, viññāṇa. Focusing on one aspect of the object is because of ekaggatā. And then these two focuses are greatly affected by when the Uddhacca is present. It is going, it's not going to completely null this focus. It's not going to abolish the focus. For example, if you take vichikicca and adhimokkha. The adhimokkha is resolution, coming into certain kind of conclusive focus, conclusive idea. And vichikicca cannot exist together, because they are fully opposite to each other. So one can ask the question the same way, how could restlessness and ekaggatā can exist together? Because ekaggatā is a fundamental necessity of the cognitive action of cognition. One who wants to hold a bunch of oranges at the same time would never even capture one, all will fall down. So likewise, when the mind is going to focus on various aspects, its function is, it's not going to function properly. So therefore, focusing on one aspect is a fundamental quality of cognition. So therefore, ekaggatā, we cannot miss ekaggatā in any citta. So even in akusala citta, there is a certain focus on a one aspect of the object, but it becomes weaker because of the influence of Uddhacca. So citta, akusala citta, which is with Uddhacca and ekaggatā, is like a person riding on horseback. He still remains in the horseback, going up and down, not very stable, but doesn't fall down. So that is how it has been explained. Then this ekaggatā does not reduces the focus of the citta. Not only reduces the focus of ekaggatā, because there are two types of focuses, focusing on an object and focusing on one aspect of the object. It not only reduces these two abilities, but it also greatly reduces the ability of the entire mental group. Chittupada, we gave a name for this, right? Rupa and cluster of rupa was rupa kalapa. One rupa is rupa, cluster of rupa was rupa kalapa. The same way, one chitta is a nama, mentality, chitta cetasika. Group of chitta cetasikas which arise together, the Pali term is chittupada. If you remember this. Chittupada is chitta plus cetasika arising together. Chittupada in one cluster of chitta cetasika. In chittupada, we don't have two chittas. One chitta and many cetasikas, which arise at one at a time. Like rupa kalapa. Rupa kalapa is a bunch of rupas together. Chittupada is chitta connected with cetasikas. All collectively we call chittupada. So, Uddhacca present in there. For example, if you did Uddhacca, if I separate it from cetasikas, this Uddhacca effect collective functioning of this ability of the chittupada. So as a result, so how can we see these two results? This, when Uddhacca is present, the kamma is chetana, producing the results in future. The ability of kamma is greatly affected when the Uddhacca is present. You can find this in two places, evidences.
One is, you know, the Uddhacca Sampayutta Chitta, which has the most excessive type of Uddhacca, level of Uddhacca. If you remember in diploma, the monster you studied, it cannot bring a rebirth. A karma done with Uddhacca Sampayutta Chitta, 12 Chitta, can bring a result in samsara, but it doesn't bring a rebirth. Why is that? Because its ability is greatly affected by strong Uddhacca. Then the next thing is, all the Akusala Chittas never bring results, vipaka, with roots. There are no sahetuka Akusala vipaka. So the teacher's idea is, Lady Sandler suggested, the reason is, this Akchittupada, Akusala Chittupada, is always affected by this restlessness of Uddhacca, so it cannot bring a strong type of a vipaka which has roots within. So therefore, Uddhacca, what we can come into conclusion out of these evidences is, Uddhacca reduces the overall strength or ability or capacity of a chitta to give higher result. It means it weakens the chitta in terms of its ability or capacity. So that is another point, that Uddhacca makes our mind more weaker in its ability or strength, right? Then in the next page I have directly translated a passage from Venerable Chandavimala Mahathera, who studied in Myanmar and who was lived in Sri Lanka. He was a Sri Lankan. Then this passage I translated because I found it is really, really useful for meditators. So this passage contains lots of good information. So I would like to explain it paragraph by paragraph, and also I would like to read it out. So if I read the first paragraph, Uddhacca is a mental state which does not allow the mental stream of a yogi to continue in the meditation practice he has begun. It drags the mind stream into various objects which are not related with the meditation subject, and also causes various types of cittupadas to arise, taking unrelated objects in the meditation. So these are same thing, the mind has to take new objects. Not letting the mind to remain in one object or one group of objects, one object or groups of objects. If you are practicing asubha bhavana, you move from one object to another, like kesa, loma, naka, danta. If you are practicing buddha anusati, you go from buddha, arahant, samma, sambuddha, you change the object, but within a range. So it's one object or a group of objects, right? Not letting the mind to remain in one object or one group of objects is called making the mind restless and scattered. Uddhacca, which makes the mind scattered in various objects, is opposite of samadhi. So this Uddhacca, we all know, is opposite of samadhi. When our mind is wandering here and there, we cannot develop a strong samadhi focus on one object, right? So the example given, the clay ball. If a clay ball is put onto the ground, it will stick on the ground very firmly. But a ball we fill with air, if you release on the ground, it will start to bump several times. The same way, mind occupied by Uddhacca is not going to hold or focus on the object firmly, and it is shaking on a particular object. A wet clay ball which is made to fall will stick on the earth and remain still. Likewise, consciousness associated with samadhi will cognize the object very well and be stable on it firmly. Afterwards, due to the strength of strong samadhi, chittas which follow will also remain in that same object or object related to this group. He's talking about samadhi. Therefore, a yogi who has gained high level of samadhi can sustain his mind in a meditation object continuously for a long time. So when you have a strong samadhi, it not only affects that chitta, it affects the later chittas even. That's why Buddha has recommended in Majjhima Nikaya, if you are weaker in vipassana, if your mind is getting weaker in vipassana, go back to your samadhi. Go to your jhana and remain in the jhana for a while and come out. So that focus, the energy you get through the samadhi, you get through the jhana, will affect your later vipassana chittas to focus very well. So samadhi is not only affecting that particular chitta, strong samadhi, it also affects the following chittas to become also well focused. That's why after a good meditation, you wake up from a good meditation, you can focus very well in your studies. Or focus, give a talk with high focus, listen to someone's Dhamma talk with high focus, and do the chanting with a composed mind. So because the samadhi not only affects that chitta, it also affects the following chittas. But on contrary, a ball filled with air, made to fall on the ground, will bump several times without sticking on the earth like a wet clay ball. In a similar manner, some cittas do not take the object firmly, but become unstable. This is what I have made in bold. In a manner by which they will abandon the object soon. Citta has one object at a time. So even how much Uddhacca is there, it is at a one time, it cannot take two objects. So what is this restlessness? How to explain it? It becomes unstable, still there is a focus, but there is a instability in a manner by which it will soon give up that object. So likewise, when the samadhi is there, the following cittas will be always also focused on the same object or related objects. But when Uddhacca is there, the following cittas are going to give up the object soon. So that is the way. So otherwise, one citta, even though there is Uddhacca, one citta has no, there is no two objects in one citta. So it will take the object, but in a manner that it will give up that object very soon. It means with a less focus. Consciousness becomes instable upon objects in this manner, becomes instable in objects in this manner due to the presence of Uddhacca. The nature of the Uddhacca is to cause the mind stream to move away from one object to another. Right after consciousness associated with Uddhacca, another consciousness with Uddhacca arises, taking another object. Then it will be followed by another consciousness accompanied by Uddhacca, cognizing a different object. All the akusala cittas are accompanied by Uddhacca. It goes zigzag, right? There is no pattern. Goes here and there, moves into completely unrelated objects when Uddhacca is present, right? Then, when the Uddhacca is weaker, even though our mind goes astray, we can drag it, bring it back quickly. But when the Uddhacca is very excessive, it gives a real burden, real terrible time for us, for meditators, and the mind is like untamed ox. That it keeps on going here and there, and it becomes very difficult, and it gives a very huge pressure, and sometimes it is really, really disturbing. How much you put effort, the mind would not get tamed, because it is a non-self nature. Only when the conditions are there, it would get calm, right? But there is no other condition other than putting effort, right? So this sometimes a painful struggle, but results will be really pleasant. If we properly progress. While meditating of a yogi, if the strength of the arisen Uddhacca is weak, only a few cittas will arise that goes into unrelated objects. After a short while, his mind stream will come back to the meditation object. With the Uddhacca is powerful, his mind will wander in various objects for a long period. The mind goes astray for a considerable time. Consequently, what happens? His concentration will become weak. When samadhi becomes weak, even the yogi suppresses the Uddhacca and brings him back, his mind back to the meditation object, it will quickly jump away from the object. Even though we understand the mind is going away, so we bring back, after a few seconds, it goes away. We bring back, after a few seconds, it goes away. So that is the nature. I think most of us have experienced this, right? Then the next thing, very important thing, the next paragraph. Uddhacca is not a mental state that can be identified like Kamachanda, having distinguished it from other hindrances. The presence of Uddhacca, it's very difficult to identify Uddhacca separately, like Lobha or Dosa. Restlessness is one of the greatest obstacles for a meditator. So he'll explain how it works together with Kamachanda. Before that, he mentioned restless is one of the greatest obstacles for a meditator. It is not possible for a person who has not meditated to understand the pressure and torment caused by Uddhacca. Due to the disturbance of restlessness, it is hard for some yogis even to keep their mind focused on one object, even for few minutes, right? It's a huge disturbance for meditation practice. So when Uddhacca connects with Kamachanda, it takes our mind towards the objects that we like. When it is connected with Vyapada, it takes our mind towards objects that we don't like or hate, and starts to remember the past incidents, the disliking, unpleasant incidents. And when the Uddhacca, sometimes Uddhacca can become, it makes our mind restless regarding our own meditation subject. So then we start to think about our meditation in various ways, right? Where now what happens to my meditation? It has developed, so I should talk with the teacher. I should discuss. I should know where what level I am in. So these kinds of various thoughts starts to occupy, and he is wasting the time instead of focusing on the object. So likewise, Uddhacca can trick our mind and we can have various thoughts which are not related with the meditation subject. So it says in the last paragraph, Uddhacca having come together with Kamachanda, drags the mind of a yogi towards sensual objects. Being together with Vyapada, it takes the yogi's mind towards objects he hates or dislikes. Uddhacca takes the mind of a meditative objects which have no whatsoever relationship with his practice, such as happenings in the country, politics, good and bad behaviors of certain people in the country, world and incidents which happened in the past and so forth. We have set on the ground to focus on the breath or focus on the one object, and it is going here and there which have no whatsoever relationship in the action we have started to initiate, right? Then sometimes due to Uddhacca, the mind of a yogi becomes restless about his meditation practice. Some yogis having started to meditate things, now my concentration is strong. My understanding is comprehensive. I need to discuss about my growth in meditation with this and that teacher. I need to inquire more about meditation from them. These thoughts arise when the mind of yogi is restless regarding his meditation. So when such thoughts occur, one needs to recognize that they are due to the Uddhacca and try to overcome such unrelated thoughts and keep on focusing on his meditation subject. Uddhacca will become, this is a very important point, Uddhacca will become strengthened in a yogi who does not recognize, please underline this point, it's very important. Uddhacca will become strengthened in a yogi who does not recognize that various types of thinking, either regarding his own meditation or regarding other objects, is caused by Uddhacca. If we don't recognize these thoughts are caused by Uddhacca, it is going, we are going to develop it, we are going to culture it. So this is, it is the more biggest danger. If we don't find the fault, we don't see the fault as a fault, then we are going to develop it, strengthen it. So whenever, whatever unrelated thought happens regarding the meditation subject, this is nothing related. Sometimes some thoughts may appear related to that. For example, when a yogi is seeing the impermanent suffering and non-self of reality, similar like some thoughts or all the conditioned realities are impermanent, this is useless, this world is useless of living. So such thoughts may arise, they are related with meditation subject, but if it keeps on going, you know there's a limit. If it goes beyond the limit and starts to think few minutes about it, then this is something the mind is occupied by Uddhacca. So it is something practically that you have to understand, what is the limit of thinking. And thinking is important, but if it goes beyond too much excessively, that time you have to understand it is occupied by Uddhacca, right? So this is the important thing. These are the points that I want to discuss. At the same time, Venerable Lady Sayado has given a very nice simile regarding why meditators, why people should meditate. I think I mentioned this in one or two classes, not in the fundamental class. So I'll repeat it. Like Venerable Lady Sayado in his instructions for Anapana, he has given a simile of a mad person. How do we consider someone is mad? He starts to do a certain act and suddenly he moves to another act. For example, he starts eating and while he has not finished his meal, he goes to take a bath. While he has applied soap, he goes to work in the garden. So when we understand, he's not a sane person, his actions are not related to each other. And while he's talking, he talks about his house and suddenly talks about another country or about something which happened yesterday. So then we understand this person is not a sane person. We cannot have a proper discussion with him. So why is that? He moves from one action to another without any relationship. He moves from one talk to another without a relationship. So the other people cannot cope with him properly because we don't know what is the decision he's going to take next. Sometimes he may talk with us and he start to hit us, right? These are unrelated. So that is how we understand a person is whether he's sane or insane. So now, in our case, in terms of meditation, when you come to spiritual sphere, we also initiate a certain act called meditation. We start to sit and focus on breath. So what happens to us? We start on a certain act and after a few minutes, his thought starts to go about what happened yesterday, what will happen tomorrow, what happened in the class, in the country, in politics, to my mother, father. And if you have experience, they have no relationship whatsoever. It started with something, it ends up in something, it goes here and there. So whenever Lady Sayadaw says, this is also a certain kind of insanity. It's like we have a certain, our mind is like a mad person when we compare ourselves in the spiritual sphere. But even though our mind goes here and there while giving a talk, listening to a talk, our mind still wanders. But we, the thing is, not like a mad person, we don't manifest it. Even though whatever thought comes to our mind, we are not going to talk, speak it out, right? We are not going to work according to our, whatever thought happens to us. So we have a certain kind of a control over ourselves. But if we talk, think about, if we observe how our mind wanders, and if we put it into a TV, for example, if someone can bring our mind into a TV, you will find that it's completely changing one figure to another, which have no relationship with each other. So this is one called Venerable Lady Sayadaw suggests that the Putujana's mind is like a crazy mind, I would call Uddhacca mind, when it comes to focusing on one object. So that's why when we are talking about nobles like Buddhas, Pacheka Buddhas, Arahants, Anagamis, they have a very high focus and their mind is not scattered in that manner. So whenever they start a certain act, they can very easily focus on that without getting any disturbance from their thoughts. So it is very important to get rid of this insanity and to be well, to become humans who can focus on their, on what we have initiated. Right. So then, Uddhacca in Suttanta method is a sanyojana which fetters the beings to the round of samsara, and it belongs to the Uddhambhagiya sanyojana. You know there are 10 sanyojanas: sakkaya ditti, vichikicca, sirabbata paramasa, kamachanda, kamaraga vyapada, then ruparaga, arupaparaga, mana, Uddhacca, avijja. Right. So this is Uddhambhagiya. Uddhacca is fully eradicated with the attainment of arahatta magga. Right, so the, finally to conclude, we also know Uddhacca reduces the strength of ekaggatā, and also in the vichikicca sambhuta citta, it also reduces the strength of ekaggatā. The question comes, which ekaggatā is more weaker? Connected with Uddhacca or connected with vichikicca? Actually the answer is, the ekaggatā connected with vichikicca is more weaker than the ekaggatā connected with Uddhacca. The reason is, Uddhacca, it does reduce the strength of ekaggatā, because it is shaking, but still it focuses on a one object in a manner that it would move to another object soon. But vichikicca's functioning is more serious in that sense. Vichikicca takes an object with an expectation of for another object, because the expectation has not completely cut off. It means whether there is a rebirth or not. Yes, sometimes may can be said yes, but there is an expectation, maybe it's no. If even he focuses no, maybe there is yes. So vichikicca is different from ditti. Ditti is, he considers there is no. There is no doubt in him. So ditti is a very stable kind of a mental state. So wisdom also, he decides this is it because of these conditions. Ditti also, because of this, I consider as this. Vichikicca is quite weaker. He is not in any position, whether it's correct or wrong. It's like where the karma has a result, maybe not. Buddha appear, Buddha, anyone can be a Buddha or not. So therefore, it's like when we stand upon one place, when I want to move to another place, being in the same place, I relaxes my body, like weight of the body. But I have initiated to move there, but still my leg is placed on the same place. So the strength of the weight is different. So likewise, Vichikicca focuses on one object with an expectation to move to another object. Uddhacca doesn't have such an expectation. It is restless. It has less focus. Because of this less focus, it is going to move. The next chitta, soon the chitta is going to move to another object. So in both the cases, ekaggatā is weaker. But Uddhacca in ekaggatā in vichikicca chitta is much weaker than the ekaggatā in Uddhacca. So therefore, in Dhamma Sangani, When explain the word ekaggatā in vichikicca citta and Uddhacca citta, in Uddhacca citta it has been explained with the words like cittasya titi, santiti, avattiti, avisāharo, with many words. But if you go into ekaggatā in the vichikicca sampuyutta citta, it's only titi, cittasya titi. It's just one word because of its weakness. right? So that is also one point I want to emphasize, which I didn't mention, but I think I mentioned it in the vichikicca lesson, right? So these are the points I want to discuss in this lecture. So uddhacca is the restlessness which makes the mind restless, and it reduces the focus and it shakes upon an object, and also it weakens the overall ability of the citta. So therefore the results are also getting weaker, and also uddhacca akusala cittas do contain uddhacca and ekaggatā together in a certain manner, and also uddhacca is enumerated as a cetasika only in the 12th akusala citta because of its excessiveness due to the excessive ignorance. And uddhacca is a fundamental quality for all the akusalas to arise, and when the akusalas are there, naturally the restlessness happens because of the torment caused by the akusalas. And also this uddhacca is really obstructing our meditation subject, and to a person who doesn't understand the various thoughts are caused by uddhacca, uddhacca will increase, and also the uddhacca in ekaggatā, in vichikicca citta, is more stronger than the ekaggatā in uddhacca citta. So these are the points I want to share with you. So if you have any questions, yes.
So just here is, page 62,
yeah,
the fourth paragraph, this is about uddhacca in samadhi. Yeah. Let's say vipassana, any objects that come into the mind, which is varied objects as well. So with that case, we cannot explain where it's very similar to uddhacca nature. No?
It's like this. Now, as you say, I think you understand the question, right? In vipassana meditation, in the present vipassana meditation, as mentioned by certain teachers, we focus on whatever object which comes to the mind, right? This is, if you go to the traditional way of vipassana meditation, we have a specific range of objects, right? But in modern types of techniques, there is Mahasi method, and if you go to the Mokok method, and also some teachers advocate that you have to focus on whatever object which comes to the mind and focus on them. This is not wrong, it is okay, but it is the present, this is a movement which happened at a later time. Right? So, as you said, this, when you are focusing on various objects, for example, meditator, he focuses on whatever object comes to his mind, right? Whatever object comes to his mind. So, even in such case, we are supposed to observe the objects as objects, right? As objects. So, therefore, there is a certain kind of a mental we have made mindset to focus on a certain object. So even someone is doing vipassana as instructed by present techniques, when their mind is, we are not focusing properly, at that time the teacher would say, your mind, you are not meditating, right? So therefore, in that, as your question was raised, this, when we are focusing on various objects, there is a certain mindset that we have said that you have to focus on an object as an object, right? As an object. So in that case, this, how to say, the object range, still it falls into the similar object range. So it means we have considered these objects as certain objects and we are focusing on them as objects. Otherwise, if you don't have this mindset, everyone will be meditating whatever object comes, right? So if we focus on for example, a new object comes, if we forget our meditation, if we start to talk with this, if we go start to move on this, right? That is called uddhacca. So according to this statement, when we say the range of objects, it is determined by how do you focus on a particular object. So you're with your mindset. So when you have a certain particular mindset, to focus on whatever object comes, you focus on it as an object, as an ultimate reality. So it still falls on this state. So that is what is mentioned here. Like, you have to keep that focus, right? So even whatever object comes, if you don't focus it as an object, If you focus it as something you start to enjoy that object, the teachers would say your mind is restless. It is going away. Right? So that focus of life, I think you understand this, like you have to be well focused on whatever object it comes. Right? So that is when Uddhacca is present, that focus will be removed.
So based on your explanation, my understanding would be this way. So ekaggatā, which is like a glue, right?
Yeah.
To stick the mind onto the object.
Yeah.
Depends on the power of that glue. How much there will be stay on that object for other cetasika to investigate that object.
Correct.
So let's say for samatha meditation, that would just hold onto one object. Then move on to the other.
Yeah.
The other vipassana. For me, I would not talk about the range of the object. The vipassana, you really don't know what kind of range the object would be. But talking about the way, the attitude of the mind observing the object to know the characteristic of the object. So ekaggatā in this case, not reduced by Uddhacca, then would have more power to stick on the object long enough for the other to investigate the object to know the three characteristics.
That's correct. But when you say the range of the objects, range of the object is not determined by the nature of the object itself.
That's why I'm not talking about the range of the object. I disagree with you.
No, even in samatha, for example, if you take samatha,
even the 32 body parts, 32 body parts, right? So this becomes the range of your object. But these same body parts, if someone admires them, this is not within the range of samatha objects. Same kesa, you can consider it as a beautiful thing. Same kesa, you can consider as a repulsive thing. So when you consider about the range of the objects, it's not only the nature of the object, how your attitude also makes an effect. So when we consider a range of the object, for example, we say the 32 body parts. These 32 body parts, not all 32 body parts is going to be the range of the objects. Only as long as you consider them repulsive, then they will become your range of the objects. So here even, whatever the objects comes, as long as your mindset is not accepting it as an object, then you are out of the range of the objects. For example, you hear a sound in vipassana meditation, when you are meditating. So you are instructed to focus on the sound as a sound. But the same sound, if you consider as a sound of a man or a lady, or starts to admire, then we call that object is beyond the range of the objects. Right? So that is what I mean by the range of the objects. So range of the objects is determined because of two reasons. Means when you come into samatha meditation, the nature of the object also matters, because when you start to do asubha, you can't focus on anapan, right? But also your attitude matters. So that's why it's the same 32 body parts. Sometimes we can admire and sometimes we can see they are repulsive. At the moment we are admiring, we are out of the range of the objects. Right? The same way, in vipassana meditation, as you said, whatever object can be brought into vipassana, right, can be brought into vipassana. So in modern techniques, we are asked to focus on the object as it is, right? See sound as a sound, see chitta as a chitta. This advice is given. So when this mental attitude is not there, even it is a sound, if we start to admire, we call it is out of your range of the object. Right? So that is what when we say when Uddhacca is present, we give up this attitude. So then if our mind starts to go, the same object, we can consider, oh, this happened, he talked to me and this. The same object, if Uddhacca is less and focus is well, it you can consider as impermanent reality.
Okay, second question. Earlier when you talked about insanity, right? You also mentioned Uddhacca and then ārammaṇa and the third level.
Yeah.
What about
Sukhavana? Oh, you are very sharp. Okay. Thank you for that. So when I say about insanity, if you are aware, I mentioned about I mentioned about Putujjana, then I move into Buddha, Pacheka Buddha, Arahant and Anaga. So thank you for your focus. So I deliberately Sotapanna and Sakadagami. The reason was, you know that thank you for that attention. So we have sila,
samadhi and panya. Right? So putujana, we practice this, but we haven't completed it. So we can make faults in sila, we can have samadhi, may lose it, we may have wisdom, we may not have wisdom, right? So here there are two ways to explain this. Now, for example, when we accomplish the sila, there are two types of accomplishment in Buddhism. One is you gain the quality within you, and you remove, the second is you remove the obstacles that can break your quality. For example, a monk being a Uddhacca fully practices sila without breaking any rule. For example, there are monks who practice even breaking one dukkata for 60 years, right? Like one dukkata for 60 years. The Mahathera was, few were there who was up in the cave and who just once told, people thought he's an arahant, right? He said, I want to meet the Maitreya Buddha. Then he said, oh, people have gathered to see you are passing away, lots of line of people are there. How can we say you are Uddhacca, people are expecting you to be around? Then he said, please go out there. And after a few minutes, he said, please come in. Now you can tell that the arahant is going to pass away. Then they asked, how could you do like that? He said, the thing was not attaining arahantship in a shorter time was difficult. For all these 60 years, I kept all my upasampada sila without breaking even one dukkata. Deliberately. That was the difficulty, right? For example, it's like you can keep sila for a high level, but that is called attaining. So it is like, for example, adding plus and removing minus. This is what I want to say. It's like you practice sila as putujana, we increase the sila, but there is always possibility of a putujana that his sila, a kalesa may come in and he may break the sila. Possibility is there. So someone may have jhana. But as long as he's a putujana or a sotapanna sakadagami, there is a possibility that his hindrances may come up and he may lose the jhana. A person may develop vipassana wisdom, but there are ignorance latently which can disturb his wisdom. So when we say sila samadhi panna, a putujana can develop them, but still he possesses the negative things that can disturb or break his sila samadhi and panna. So when we become sotapanna, even a person has just observed the five precepts as a lay person, still there is no hindrance within him because of which he may break the sila that he observes. Even if he is a lay person, he may just protect the five silas. He may become, after he become a monk, after you observe all the silas, it's not possible that deliberately he may break this. It means the negatives that can break effective sila are not there. So we call sotapanna is a sile paripurakari. He has completed the sila. Completed the sila doesn't mean he is upasampada. He follows all the rules. Paripurakari means completed the sila. It means there are no obstacle, defilements that can remove his sila which he has observed. Whatever sila he has observed, there is no obstacles, that there are no defilements that would come up and he would break the sila. So we call him sile paripurakari. So samadhi paripurakari becomes after the third level, anagami. So whether he has jhana or not, so that's why he, when we say paripurakari accomplished the samadhi, doesn't mean in the plus way. Plus way means you have to have the 8 jhana. Paripurakari here means he doesn't have the obstacles within him which can disturb his samadhi. Anagami, after attaining a samadhi, it's impossible that he may lose it because of defilements. He may not lose it because of defilements. Because defilements are not going to come up like putujana and destroy this jhana. Because there's kamaraga patika is missing. The greatest obstacle for samadhi is missing. So therefore, he is called a samadhi paripurakari. Panya paripurakari means arahan who has no defilement at all. But it doesn't mean that he possesses all the wisdoms possible in the world. He doesn't have the ignorance that which is opposite of defilement, opposite of wisdom. So when I say, as you said, when I said the incentive means like, I said, putujanas have this incentive, But and then I say Buddha, Paccheka Buddha, Arahants and Anagami, and I gave up these Sotapanna and Sakadagami because even though they have defilements, but it is not very strong like us. It's not strong like us, but still they may possess defilements because they still have Kamaraga and Patika. The greatest obstacles of samadhi are still within them, even at a lower level. So that's why I deliberately omitted these two. So Putujjana's mind, it doesn't mean that all Putujjana are like insane. Like if you have a very composed mind, like if you focus well, his mind is very well tamed, right? So I'm not insulting all the Putujjanas, but I generally say, and when you say that someone is full in samadhi, we stop in Anagami level, even a Sakadagami and Sotapanna, even he has jhana, but still there is his obstacles of jhana are still there. And also I want to mention, if Anagami has attained the samadhi, his samadhi will not be disturbed by kilesa. That is also another case. But still his mind, as a normal person, his mind is obstructed by this Kamaraga and Patika.
Just out of curiosity, in terms of sila, for Sotapanna and Sakadagami,
yeah.
In terms of sila, you mentioned hindrances that for them not to liberate,
break
the sila. Is it from just action? What about my like arising?
Arising to break. Intention to break, you mean?
So is it just considered that, let's say, if they don't break any of the five silas, by action, what about by like?
No, the intention to kill will not happen.
Not the intention to kill, but like, arises the thoughts of like, oh, you know, let's say I want to drink alcohol, but they're not drinking it. The thought of like, okay.
Wanting will not come.
Like, so craving.
Craving will not come.
So let's say an alcoholic, that person becomes a sustapanna, was an alcoholic.
Yeah.
After the sustapanna, absolutely no craving.
No craving at all.
Not even thinking. Are you sure?
Yes. So, okay, we'll meet, time has passed, we'll take a break and...